What is up, amigos? Today we're talking about delta wings. We're going through what they are, how they work, and subsonic versus supersonic, because their performance is a little bit different depending on what kind of regime we're in. So first of all, what are they? Well, as the name suggests, they are wings that are shaped as the Greek letter delta, so a triangle. So let's say we have, looking down on this planform here, this is the shape that it is, this triangle, and the flow is coming this way with a free stream velocity of u infinity. Now, as we pitch the delta wing up, so if you look at it from the side and we pitch it up, the flow coming along here will start to separate along this leading edge. Now, is that good or bad? On a regular airplane, that's usually pretty bad. That results in a massive loss in lift. But for a delta wing, the opposite occurs. So we have the flow coming along here, and if this leading edge is sharp, the flow will detach, and now a vortex on each side will form. One this way and one this way, and it'll travel down fairly close towards the leading edge, hugging that, and then the flow coming over the rest of the airfoil will then get sucked down to the airfoil because of this vortex is a low pressure core. And why is that good? Well, if we were to look at the lift coefficient slope, so we have the angle of attack down here and the lift coefficient here, and we were to plot a regular airfoil, let's say a NACA 0020, and it's just a typical airfoil, no delta wing, just not regular planform, and we were to plot the lift versus the angle attack, it will increase fairly linearly and then it will drop off. And this angle attack is maybe about 12 degrees. For a delta wing, on the other hand, we'll see that we did the exact same thing. The lift starts to increase a lot, and to begin with, we see that the slope is not as great as for the regular NACA 0020 airfoil. So that's the delta wing here. But as we get to 12 degrees, we'll notice that the flow is not separating. We're not getting stalled. And in fact, if we start to increase the angle attack even more, the lift will start to go higher and higher until we get to like 40, 50, even 60 degree angle attack before the flow starts to separate and then we get a drop in lift. That is the major benefit of delta wings. They can go to much higher angles of attack and still produce a lot of lift. And that is because of these vortices that are these low pressure cores sucking the flow down and not letting it detach. Now, one thing that we should note is what happens as we increase the angle of attack. Well, as we increase the angle of attack, these vortices, which usually start here and go all the way downstream and even propagate past the trailing edge of the delta wing, will start to pop. So if, let's say, we're at 5 degrees, they might start to pop around here. We go to 10 degrees, they might be about here. We go to 15, they start creeping up further and further before they really start just popping as soon as they form. So the entire airfoil will be in separated flow, and that's what we really get around here. But that happens in a very large angle attack. Now, in terms of the leading edge, we can still kind of produce vortices when the leading edge is somewhat rounded. So let's say we have leading edge and it looks either like very sharp like this, or we round it. We will still get vortices forming, but on this sharp leading edge, the flow will separate much more and almost completely compared to this rounded edge. Now, in terms of what this, the effects it has on the lift and drag coefficient, let's look at this. So let's say we have the lift coefficient first. The leading edge, which is rounded, will usually be more like this. So it will be somewhere between not having a delta wing and having a very sharp leading edge delta wing. So we have a higher lift curve slope, but then we'll also get separation a little bit earlier. If we were to look at the drag coefficient, on the other hand, so let's say we have the alpha versus the drag coefficient. Let's say we have the sharp edge first. We start to get a fairly high drag coefficient compared to the rounded leading edge, which will be a little bit lower. Now, that is because we don't have as much separated flow. Now, is that a good thing? Well, for subsonic flow, that is potentially a good thing. But for supersonic flow, this is where we get a difference occurring. So the sharper the leading edge, generally speaking, the lower something called the wave drag will be. And that is literally just the drag that comes around about due to like the compression of the flow. So you can kind of think of it as the shock wave. You can kind of think, okay, the shock wave is going to be weaker. That's not exactly true, exact reason, because we do get a lower wave drag as we approach the subsonic flow. That is just a good general representation in terms of visually that we can understand it. Okay, the shockwave will be weaker, so there's not going to be as much drag on the airfoil. So if we have a sharp leading edge, that's going to reduce the wave drag of the airfoil and the airplane as we go to supersonic speeds. On the other hand, if we have a rounded leading edge, that's going to result in the airfoil being producing more wave drag as we go to supersonic speeds, and then that increases the drag overall. So really, depending on what we are designing the airfoil for, we can kind of choose what we want to do with this leading edge. Now, let's talk about the one final thing, the lift, the pressure coefficient over the airfoil. So let's say we have, we're looking at the back of the airfoil, we take this cut plane here, and we look from either way. So we have this plane here, and we're going to plot the pressure coefficient. So let's say we have the pressure coefficient here, this being negative, along this airfoil. We know that we could get vortices forming here, here and here. So let's look at what the pressure coefficient is. So on the top surface, we actually get something that looks like this. So this is the pressure coefficient, and I'll explain what this means in a second once I've finished drawing these arrows. And on the bottom, we'll get something more like this. Now, this is the pressure coefficient on the bottom compared to the top. And if you want to look at how much lift something is being is producing, for example, on an airfoil or whatever, we can just look at the area under this graph between these two lines. If we look at, we do that, we integrate, we see automatically that near the leading edges, we get a lot more lift being produced because we have these peaks occurring here compared to over the rest of the airfoil. And that literally means over these vortices, over these, near the leading edge of this delta wing, we are producing a lot more lift than if we go closer to the center, which is actually quite different to most other wings. Usually it's the other way around. Most other wings, you drop off as you go to the leading, to the sides of the airfoil in lift, but we don't actually get that occurring here. So we can see that the edges are actually producing a lot more lift. That's where a lot of lift is coming from for this airfoil. And that's also as we go to high angle attack, where we're getting a lot more lift being produced. So that is what a delta wing is, how it works, and the difference between a supersonic and a subsonic airfoil and how you would design it. If you like this video, make sure to like and click the subscribe button, and I'll see you soon. Peace out, amigos.